Why did the chicken cross the road? Because there was a black guy walking behind him. And he was nervous. He was new to the city, this chicken. And he was like, I feel like he's following me, but I'm not sure. By the way, don't be upset, because this is not a racist joke. This joke is not racist. The chicken was racist. The chicken was definitely racist. But that's chickens. You kind of can't blame them, considering that their species murder rate is 100%.
Sanctimony is easy and outrage is fun. Everyone gets to point and say, there's the bad guy. But that doesn't make us good. I mention this because America is in a sex panic. The media coverage is so overblown that the public is becoming hysterical. The public is being sold on the idea that we are in a crisis. It would be a lot more honest if we acknowledged that everyone is a little bit kinky. Even the pious ones in the pews on Sunday pretending that they aren't.
Okay, here's the last of our 5-point questions. Girls, tell me where specifically is the weirdest place that you personally, girls, have ever gotten the urge to make whoopee? The weirdest place, Olga? Yes, Olga?
In the ass?
No.
Of course, this is not to excuse crimes or even bad manners. Rather, the shaming of sexual peccadilloes in the media, in part fairly, is a denial of the humanity which defines us. It is absolutely a fool's errand to attempt to legislate the line between what is and what is not acceptable in courtship, where the reality is that a pass is romantic if she likes you and it's well delivered, but harassment if she doesn't like you or if it's overly awkward. Look at the history of mankind. Murder, rape, and robbery have been illegal forever. Nevertheless, people continue to murder, rape, and rob. The reality is that life will never be completely safe and comfortable. Nature is cruel and unforgiving. No number of laws or social oppressions will remove the humanity from mankind, which, frankly, should not even be our goal. Quite to the contrary, we should foster freedom because we know that destructive deviances arise from the repression and not the liberation of the human spirit. In my view, we would be better off accepting the primordial nature of life. We would be better off accepting that the best that we can do is to strive to treat others as we would have them treat us, and that we will not always succeed. We should be ready to forgive others because the time may come when we need to be forgiven. That said, there's a bigger picture here. If we take as true the consensus that the Russians were successful in weaponizing fake news by amplifying it in social media, and were by those means able to deprive Hillary Clinton of her rightful place on the throne of history, a claim for which there is no actual proof, it follows that we should assume that others besides the Russians endeavor to influence American public opinion through social media. If social media is as effective in framing public opinion as the noise machine insists, we should assume that the American government and American business, among others, are also running propaganda campaigns in social media. Look at the path the internet is on. What we are witnessing is increasing suppression of dissent. The ultimate objective, of course, is to suppress freedom of thought. There are two major prongs to this effort. First, dissent is slandered as fake news and is drowned out by the mainstream media, which is a virtual monopoly. Second, advertising money is drying up. Not only are ad blockers now ubiquitous, but also no one clicks on banner ads anymore. In addition, internet traffic is migrating to cell phones, which don't have the screen space for much advertising. On top of this, social media outlets are actively censoring content which does not fit the narratives prescribed by the advertisers. The end game for the internet is that independent journalists and philosophers will be marginalized, if not crushed altogether. Eventually, the only free content on the internet will be material supplied by the advertising agencies, think tanks, and the entertainment industry. And this material will be paid for by the government, the rich, and big business. Eventually, the internet will provide only the official news. In fact, we are already most of the way there. All we ever learn is that the economy is fine, that it's normal to be in perpetual war, and that safety is more important than freedom. We never hear why our country is literally falling apart, how the environment and the food and water supplies are contaminated, or about the exploding cancer rates and the fact that health care is essentially unavailable to the majority of Americans. It's not difficult to imagine how society will look when our culture and the commercial interests which prey upon us merge.
You seem very much alone, John Spartan, but things aren't all that different. Perhaps you'd like to hear an oldie station. Oldies?
Oh, what a relief!
Oh, this is the most popular station in town. Wall-to-wall mini-tunes. You call them commercials.
Here's that classic you've all been waiting for. The number one request of the day. Armor hot dogs.
Kids eat Armor hot dogs.
Oh, wow. This is my fave.
Kids who climb on rocks. Dog kids, sissy kids.
Even kids with chicken pox love hot dogs.
Armor hot dogs.
The dogs.
Kids love to bite.
Somebody put me back in the fridge.
If we take as true that public opinion can be effectively influenced through social media, should we not consider the possibility that the sex panic gripping America is either a deliberate effort to manipulate public opinion, or at the very least an experiment in thought control? After all, the media onslaught bears the marks of classic propaganda. On the one hand, these reports, such as Louis C.K. painting the ceiling in front of some female friends who would have preferred not to have watched, are dominating daytime and evening news and daytime, evening, and late-night talk shows. On the other hand, there's not much dissent, at least not much being aired. No one is on the air arguing that the untoward and sometimes illegal conduct is predictable human behavior given the socialization of the people involved and the circumstances in which they were acting. No one is on the air arguing for understanding and compassion. The fact is that it's just too much fun to be outraged, and this is an easy way to score points. Thinking of the sex panic as a generated narrative, or at least a narrative which is being amplified, within the context of the path the internet is on, we have to ask, where is all of this going? For example, what if information were developed that the Beatles had sex with underage girls? My guess is that if such information were developed at an inflection point advantageous to those interested in suppressing art, the fuzz would be all over it. The noise machine would scream until the public demanded that the Beatles' music, which everyone agrees is great, be taken off the air. It's no small irony that this music used to be considered revolutionary. Rock and roll used to be considered a worthy and necessary rebellion against authoritarianism and sexual hypocrisy. When the Beatles brought rock and roll back to America, the 60s let out a roar the universe will still hear in 500 years. And yet we are at the brink of the public giving the victory back. Obviously, there's a lot to think about. In closing, let me boil this brief overview down to two points. First, if sex is an act of rebellion, then for the sake of humanity, we must rebel. Second, if you are asked to take sides between safety and freedom, and you are every day, pick freedom. It can be messy, and sometimes a good person is hurt, but it's infinitely preferable to the alternative.